cursed by the old gods in Bethany. We are five immortals doomed to walk the earth until we complete our 1001 tasks. After centuries of having our memories picked around, we're ready to complete our destiny and die. We are, for now, the Immortals. This is episode 63.
Woohoo!
Three is half of six.
Three is half of six.
And it's also divisible by nine, so I can sing that nine song again that I told you about at episode 54 and how great it is.
Do it.
Nine times nine is eight is 63. Six and three is nine times any number you can find. It all comes back to nine.
Huh.
It's from square one.
You know, we had a fan last week suggest that there used to be an Immortals drinking game, and like,
yeah.
I see it now. You know, you two just doing weird math things.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Math is fun.
Math is fun.
Math is not fun.
This is not a math podcast.
It could be, though.
It should be, though.
Should not be.
I feel like I know a lot about podcasts. I don't know any math podcasts.
Well, yes. There you go. That's a whole area we could explore.
We could. We won't.
Aww.
For we are the Immortals. Every week, we review the 1001 movies, albums, food, songs, children's books, and television shows that you must consume before you die. That would be a very simple podcast, but we're not a simple podcast. We're not just doing this for fun. This isn't just an amusing thing we do once a week. We do this for the sake of our own anti-survival.
We want to die.
Yeah.
We have a death wish.
As we said, you know, earlier in the intro. So, you know, Bethany, from the intro, she's wreaking havoc over in the god realm.
Wrecking or wreaking havoc?
Wreaking.
Is it wreaking havoc?
Wreaking. It's spelled wrecking.
I thought
wrecking.
You just kind of pronounced it different.
It's spelled wrecking, but I think you pronounce it wreaking.
No, yes. It's spelled wreaking.
Is it?
W-R-E-A-K.
Oh, yeah, it's an A, isn't it?
Yep.
I don't know. Wreck always had it's such a great verb.
Well, wreck is like, also W-R-E-A-K.
No, wreck has a C in it.
W-R-E-A-K. Oh, yeah, there is. Okay. But the E and the A thing is...
This isn't a spelling podcast either, by the way.
It could be.
It really couldn't.
I'm more into a spelling podcast than a math podcast.
As long as we basically just make fun of Austin the whole time.
We could rank all the podcasts this could be, and we all know Doctor Who Appreciation is the top one.
Well, I mean, if we rank more things, is that just giving Bethany more power?
I don't know.
Just like for free?
We don't really know.
Well, that's what I was saying. We do these reviews not only to kind of complete the curses, but also she's threatening to hurt us because these reviews somehow power her bad plan.
Yeah.
But luckily, we got a mole on the inside, intern from previous episodes. He possesses Adam's body and helps us out as we're trying to figure out to stop her. But also, he gives us what number to do for each review. We're not going to go in order. That'd be boring.
We just
jump around, basically. And this week...
Get up and get down.
Yeah. Like that. Just like that.
Just like that.
It's just like that. This episode, we're doing 363.
Did you know that three is half of six? And that also it's a palindrome.
Yeah.
Which is not interesting.
Yeah, it is.
Not for numbers.
This is, I don't know if it's our first one, but it is directly after something we have done already.
Is it?
Yeah.
I think we've done it before, too. Also, that's not...
That's not how that works. 362. We've got 362?
I believe so, yeah.
Oh.
You've memorized those.
Well, no, because I saw in the book that 362 was right next to Elvis, and it was the, something. A song.
Let's get to the show.
No!
We're so close. Anywho, so, since we know all of you have bought these six books that we're doing, and you have numbered them personally, you will know that the 363rd entries are the following. The movie is Breakfast at Tiffany's.
The album is Oxygene by Jean-Michel Jarre, I think.
The food is Gull Egg.
The song is Always on My Mind by, well, as performed by Elvis Presley.
The children's book is The Day the Babies Crawled Away by Peggy Rathman.
And the television show is Edge of Darkness. But now, let's get right into it and have breakfast at Tiffany's.
Won't you join me?
Yes, join Audrey Hepburn as you've never seen her before, kicking over the traces and bringing to life Truman Capote's Breakfast at Tiffany's.
I never could do that.
Audrey Hepburn as Holly Golightly, who typifies and glorifies the glamorous playmates of this dizzily spinning world as she and George Peppard breeze through the glitter and shimmer of New York as it has never been captured before. You have a special invitation to attend Audrey Hepburn's open house on the wildest night New York ever knew.
Breakfast at Tiffany's is a 1961 film directed by Blake Edwards of the Pink Panther fame. It is from a novella by Truman Capote of In Cold Blood fame and just being famous.
Truman Capote.
He's a really popular guy who has two major things and lots of other essays. Whatever. The point is this. This is a very popular film. After having many weeks where we reviewed Andrei Rublev, Voyage to Italy, The Last Picture Show. This is a film that, like, everyone at our fake ages right now, because we're not actually in our 20s, has heard of at least, or they have a poster in their dorm rooms about.
There's a song about this movie.
That has, like, two lines of that song about this movie.
There's a song in this movie that's really famous.
It won the Oscar.
Mm-hmm.
It stars Audrey Hepburn, some guy, and another actor we'll talk about probably for most of the review.
Well, and another
Do
one
you guys
as well.
All know the one-hit wonder song, Breakfast at Tiffany's, the 1995?
Yes.
The one that you, like, sang last week?
That I was obsessed with? Yeah. No, well, I mean, I feel like its chorus perfectly encapsulates a lot of things, which is, and I said, what about Breakfast at Tiffany's? She said, I think I remember the film, and if I recall, I think we both kind of liked it. And I said, well, that's one thing we got. Meaning one thing they have in common that will save their relationship.
Is that the song that was in the movie?
No. It's a one-hit wonder by a band called Deep Blue Sea.
How could it be in the movie?
Nothing else. Oh. It would not make a lot of sense to have in the movie.
It's about a couple talking about seeing the film.
Not only that, but the song came out like 30 years after the movie.
I don't know 35 anything about the song. I was wondering if that was the title of the song.
We'll play it for you.
Whatever.
The podcast.
So, this is the story of Holly Goodlightly, who is...
Goodlightly.
Holly Goodlightly, yeah.
She is a person who is full of all sorts of quirks and interesting things.
Boring.
Like, you know, she's sort of dating a guy in jail. She has a cat named Cat that she won't name. Well, she has, you know, all these silly things in her apartment. She puts her phone in the suitcase to kind of...
Because it muffles the sound.
Muffles the sound out. All sorts of weird...
Unplug the phone, but what? I don't know.
Yeah. And a new guy comes into the apartment building and is amused and tolerates her more than others, basically. And they start a romance as they kind of figure out more about Holly and her past. And where she goes to the future, and how much of her life is just a facade. And, yeah. So I know that Pedro had never seen it before, and Sarah basically hadn't seen it before, because, let's save that part for near the end.
Sure.
But you couldn't get past the 5-minute mark, and then the 5:01 mark, the 5:03 mark, basically.
I got about, like, 30 seconds further every time I tried it, which was, it was on Netflix for probably about 3 years. I probably tried to watch this movie like somewhere between 5 and 10 times and never got past the 5th minute.
Yeah. So, Pedro, what did you think?
I loved this movie.
Really?
Knew it.
I really loved this movie. It was just so nice and swell and fun. And I love everything about it and all the people. And it made me feel good inside.
Sarah, what did you think of the movie?
I fucking hated this movie. Jesus. Oh, God, it made me mad. Everything about this movie makes me mad. I'll put aside the racist landlord for a later conversation, but I mean, look, like, this, there's the trope of the manic pixie dream girl, right? The girl whose purpose in life is to, like, be weird and spontaneous, and that makes her attractive and interesting to men, and fundamentally, that is her worth.
Well, that phrase comes from an article back with the AV Club did all this
list. Yeah, it
list.
Was an AV Club article.
And Nathan Rabin, a fantastic writer, who is now hysterically, like, tied to this phrase for the rest of his life, He had a list of the Manic Pixie Dream Girls, and it came from initially Kirsten Dunst's character from Elizabethtown.
A terrible movie.
Really bad movie. And on that list was Holly for Best of Tiffany's.
Yeah.
And more, a lot of more recent examples, especially Natalie Portman in Garden State. Those kind of characters.
Friggin' 500 Days of Summer is the other one that's like a totally...
Yeah.
But, so I will give, and I mentioned 500 Days of Summer actually because I think to give it its due, this movie is aware that Holly is a sort of one-dimensional or otherwise silly character and tries to problematize some of it. But in the end, the solution to all her problems is that she really just has to find a man who will take care of her. And that is some fucked up shit. And it's just like, it's everything that is, it's this twisting of modern female liberation that just pulls you straight back into male dominance in a way that fucking sucks. So like, characters like this, and I actually think that she is in many ways the prototypical character, like just the first I can think of in film. She's interesting because she's independent, right? She's interesting because she's made all these choices that make her this strong, independent woman, and she's made all these choices that are sort of anti-feminist choices, or sorry, pro-feminist choices, if you will, and, you know, anti-establishment, you know, interesting choices. But in the end, really the message of the movie is all that shit made her unhappy, and you know what's gonna make her happy? The embrace of a loving man. And that is some bullshit, and it's so frustrating. And I hate it, and I want to do a whole podcast about how I hate this person and everyone that she spawns.
You know that you're on a podcast.
No, but I want to talk for like hours about this, about how much I hate this.
20, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Leigh, do you share some of these thoughts?
Yeah, she's definitely the prototypical Manic Pixie Dream Girl, and I understand why a bunch of college freshman females currently have a picture of Audrey Hepburn hanging in their dorm room with some sort of drivel scrawled across it in Lucinda font, but I never really wanted to be that person, so because I always just found this person tiresome. She goes out of her way to make her life different. Because she wants to be different, because she doesn't want to be like anybody else, and it's frustrating, because nothing she does, like Sarah said, makes her happy. Everything makes her miserable, except blatant consumerism at Tiffany's, which is also annoying.
See, I guess I think the film is fine. I don't hate it as much as Sarah does, because I don't think anyone could, but...
I hate it so much!
I just... find it to be a bit empty, and doesn't fill its quota, really. But okay, Adam, what do you think? How do you embrace Holly?
I mean, I like the film, and I think that she's. I wouldn't say she's as independent as the whole time, because she's. Pretty much from the beginning, looking for a rich husband. She wants a husband the whole time. That's what she wants.
Mm-hmm.
I guess as a byproduct of getting money, because that's really what she wants. And then in the end, I don't think that it's a man that necessarily solves her problem, but it's a man that she actually has a relationship with and cares about. So I think that I'm not saying, Sarah, you're totally wrong. I'm just saying that this is not the worst movie that has done.
No, it's not. There are definitely way worse culprits. I actually think that as feminism evolves and independence of women becomes more and more of a threat, the media trope evolves in its like insidious bullshit, and then at some level, like, this movie is still close enough to, it's still old enough that it doesn't actually hit at many of the tropes, the really awful tropes, I think, that the Manic Pixie Dream Girl hits. And I do think that it's not, I mean, yeah, like, as you said, the fact that she is actively on a quest for money, for example, and a rich husband, makes it a different kind of story than your average Manic Pixie Dream Girl story, which is even worse because it's about, like, how, you know, she's so, like, anti-materialistic, and, like, that's how the guy really finds himself, is, like, by meeting her, you know, and, like, realizing her, like, himself. But I do think that, so I like that part. I think you're right. I think that fundamentally it is more about connection that saves her than just a man, any man.
I think there's something...
It doesn't change the fact that she doesn't save herself, right? Like, that's the problem.
I think also, because to me the thing that I dislike the most about Manic Pixie Dream Girls is that she is a device for the man to discover himself.
Yeah.
And that's not necessarily
that's
here.
That's not much of an issue in this movie.
So I don't...
I still think that there's some
there's
aspect
some
of it, though.
Oh, there's definitely something
it's
to
some,
it.
It's some, but he's not now bohemian. And he's pretty similar to what he was at the beginning, just with the appreciation for a person, not a whole different, like... He's not Zach Braff.
No.
You know, it's not the song that's going to change your life, and now he's different than all his
he's
good
kind
ways.
Of the same person as her in the beginning.
Yeah, because it's
goes
it's
around.
Interesting.
Well, he's got a sugar mama.
Yeah.
Like, oh.
But looking at what Holly kind of wants throughout the film is pretty interesting, because in the middle of the film, we find out that she's had this other life, and she was married when she was 14. The film,
yeah,
like, does not.
Yeah, which the
film
does not
seem
to have a problem with.
That wasn't a thing at that time period, right? Like,
no,
we,
I mean,
we sort of gotten past.
I know our memories have been altered.
It's pretty unusual. Like, it's yeah.
But it was done without love, and it was done without any sort of, like, she felt no pride in it because she had no connection, she had no love, she had no connection to the children that were involved. So a lot of what Holly wants, and Holly as the creation of Lulu, I think her name was, is that Lulu May, is that the riches is to create the life that she wants, that she sees in the Tiffany's window.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the extension of the creation, and she has a belief that marriage does not need love, but she needs to get something more out of it. So that's what she kind of wants through Tiffany's. So I don't think it's necessarily materialistic, it's just the way to kind of help make her facade. And what I liked about her relationship with Fred Paul. Is that the thing that really, like, at first she's using him as a lampshade. She's just rambling and monologuing while he listens, and she's amused by that. But then she becomes more interested to him because there's someone else in his life, and she's amused. And now she's like, oh, but I can't just have that. But then what really kind of connects her to him for the long run, early on in the relationship, is that he made a book. And it's something that, like, he made. Because she's never looking to, like, have a job or have a life that requires working. But for the once in this whole story, she's attracted by the idea of working, especially since it's about articulation of the emotions. That's what she can't do. So she is bragging about this book from beginning to end. And I find that to be a really interesting thing, especially since when you look at her materialism, the thing that she then has the most affection for from Tiffany's costs less than $10.
Mm-hmm. So, that is a really lovely scene, I think. The Tiffany scene itself is cool.
That guy behind the counter, champ.
Yeah,
I thought he
is.
Was so
he
funny.
Is awesome.
He was the best employee ever, not letting his opinion of these cheap customers ruin his moment.
I mean, to be honest, he probably doesn't have much of an opinion on them because he works behind the counter at Tiffany's. It's probably
yeah.
a breath of fresh air from his usual clientele.
Yeah.
The kind of people that buy a sterling silver phone dialer, which I thought was ridiculous.
It's such a lovely concept. I mean, what is it? A sterling silver phone dollar, it's got
to
just be like
a little stick that
like
you use
to
spin the dial around.
It's delightful,
because,
and I
you know,
want
you,
one in my life.
Would rich people don't want to use their fingers.
But, you know, if you were really rich, those are just the posers. If you were really rich, you don't dial your own phone.
So it doesn't help, too, my hatred of this movie that I also really hate Tiffany's, which is not great. But no, I mean, like, it's the ultimate symbol of not really it's not that it's not classy. It's that, I mean, it's largesse, but it's not one of a kind, right? I mean, like, you get your Tiffany's ring, and it's purely a symbol of wealth, really. And I think that is interesting in Holly's story. She's not interested in the one-of-a-kind life that it almost seems like she is. Like, in the end, she wants Tiffany's. Like, she wants the status symbol, the thing that's on Madison Avenue.
Yeah, but, like, I'm okay with that because you...
No, I know. I mean, I think it's a notable fact about her character.
Mm-hmm.
Not gonna go so far as to say interesting. But like, I do not like this movie. But
if there's something that you like, jewelry, cars, what have you, you're inevitably gonna have a favorite brand, that dream, whatever, and it's almost always gonna be some sort of object that can be taken as a status symbol. So I think. Just kind of happened to be Tiffany's. It could have just as easily been, I don't know, Chanel or
Zales.
Sure,
you're talking about like a not jewelry store.
Yeah, sure. Anything. Zales. So,
Porsche.
Well,
yes.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. I found her to be fun and just whatever. I'm gonna just do things. I didn't find her to be that sporadic. What do you say? Just I'm gonna do things just to be different because she was highly predictable. Everything she did,
I think that's only because we're so used to the trope.
Exactly.
Now,
I think
keeping a phone in a suitcase, that's just purposefully difficult.
Well, I didn't see her as I want to be different. I'm gonna put a phone in a suitcase. No, I honestly saw her as I'm trying to sleep and this thing's ringing. Where will it shut up? Boom. I saw the chaos in her life. Not as ooh, I want to be quirky. I was convinced by it. I thought it was legit.
And at the same time, though, I feel like that's the flaw of the character concept, right? Because, I agree with you, right? Within the world of the film, she's not, quote-unquote, trying to be quirky. But the appeal of the character is this sort of... oh, look at her. Look at how, sort of odd and winsome she is. And fundamentally, the kinds of strangeness and the kinds of affectations that she has are all screaming, take care of me, take care of me, take care of me. And I think ultimately that is where the film lands, is that Holly does need someone to take care of her. And I'm not saying, I need someone to take care of me, right? Companionship's a good thing. But there's a neediness to that quirkiness that is, here's the truth, that the real thing that bugs me about these kinds of characters is calling out to the male audience to say, as basically a male insertion fantasy, go save this girl. You're gonna be the guy who gets to go save this girl. And it sucks. As a woman to watch, it sucks.
It particularly is annoying in this movie because, where in the right does he have to save anybody?
Yeah,
he starts this movie
fuck?
As a
He's
prostitute.
Yeah. I agree.
Well, you know,
so he doesn't have the right to like someone, though? That's
no, no, no,
no.
He doesn't have the right to save
people.
Anybody.
That's the
and that's
or,
what it goes to
or
do.
Lecture her, I guess.
Okay, lecture her, sure.
And but. That's the thing, does he even like her?
I think he does.
I think so, too.
I
think he likes the idea of her.
I think that the most interesting movies that have problematized this concept, and actually there's really fun debate, I think, about whether 500 Days of Summer is a Manic Pixie Dream Girl movie or a movie that's dumb or a really smart movie about the Manic Pixie Dream Girl concept that's, amazing.
Oh, no, I hate that movie.
I actually tend to go for the second, but I do think that he's attracted to the idea of her.
I think at the beginning, he's amused by her, but then,
he's more amused about how somehow it always just works out for her. Because, it always seems like he's...
But right, that's bullshit.
That's fine. That's funny to me. It's how the hell did... How do you fall ass backwards into luck, like, all the time? You should be getting arrested at a party or whatever, and somehow you just kind of walked out at the right time.
But there was a wonderful moment, I thought, because I think the film, one of its flaws for me is that it's not very funny, which is unfortunate because, well, the novella, I remember reading it years ago, but it's not like this, my memory. Like, it's a stranger look at a type of New Yorker. It's way more about the crime elements going on. From my memory, I could be totally wrong. But the moment I thought I really liked was at her party, where she apparently knows 2,000 people, and they're all in her apartment, and she has one of those French cigarette holders, but it's like a foot longer than any other one, and I don't think she knows she has one that's like
stupid
hysterically
length.
Cruella de Vil like length. I think she just thinks she is wearing something fancy. But when she's talking to someone, she lights someone's like scarf or his headpiece on fire. And the only one who notices is Fred Paul, who's trying to get through the crowd to stop the fire. But in the process of her just being, I think, a bit drunk and aloof, looks at what time it is on some guy's watch, and while he's holding a drink, pours out the drink on the fire and no one notices. Like, she... That was a really amusing moment of... It worked. Like, the creation that she wants isn't real, of the perfect person who could go to Tiffany's every morning just to kind of, like, see the new stock kind of thing. It's the middle ground. And that's kind of what the film's really about. But I guess the question I have right now is, for this person who, you know, had to spend years getting rid of her... apparently hideous southern accent, and she's pretending to be regal and whatnot. Is Audrey Hepburn miscast? Because I kind of think so. Even though, like, she did this exact plot in My Fair Lady, and that works really well for me, I think she's almost too Roman Holiday in this. Like, she's not like a struggling New Yorker, I guess, for me.
The Wikipedia page had mentioned that Marilyn Monroe was suggested for the role, and I think that would have been a much better movie.
I think better. Oh,
I would have been super into that.
I don't know.
I feel like that would have gotten at the vulnerability of it. Like, Audrey Hepburn is many things, but, like, she is always the coolest person in the room, in a way. Like, vulnerability, I don't think, is really, like, where she thrives. And that's fine. I mean, like, she plays a lot of, like, really interesting, strong female characters. And sometimes turns, like, weakly written characters into strong characters, which is fun. But this one, yeah, like, there's an element of Holly that the movie wants us to see her as kind of falling apart. Like, in order for the ending to be satisfying, like, we have to kind of think that she's not doing great. And, I agree with you. I don't think Audrey Hepburn ever really, like... You don't get that feel from her. I don't know.
I think that might be one of the reasons why I'm not so taken aback. I never really saw her as falling apart. She was just, you know, getting by the way she knows how, and she doesn't feel any worse for it. Like, she's all right. I feel like if Marilyn Monroe would have done it, I would have felt like if everything goes the same way, she would have been more stupid and would have felt like an actually less competent human being.
See, I don't think so, because I think
that would have been more annoying to me. I think
the character of Holly Golightly is an idiot, though.
Yeah, like,
I didn't get that. I didn't think she was.
I thought
she
was an idiot.
Hepburn, and I think the movie but the movie works better if she's an idiot.
I wouldn't have liked it as much if she was an idiot.
Well, sure.
I don't want to see an idiot go around being like, "Oh my god, my life sucks," but I'm also an idiot, so it's my fault for being less smart than people, and so now I'm gonna have a man save me. That's annoying.
Except for the
last part. That's what that movie is.
Have you seen Girls?
Have I seen Girls?
TV show Girls?
Oh. I've seen a few episodes.
I'm not saying that they're all idiots, but they're all...
They are, though.
Way, way more incompetent than Holly and doing that exact thing. I enjoyed the show, though.
I mean...
Final season coming up.
Maybe I would like it, but...
You hate Girls?
I admittedly stopped watching after the second season, but...
That's a different conversation for a different day, because I feel like Sarah and I will agree on a lot.
A lot of
it is bound to be on the list, because it is a show.
I
think we let's cover one more thing before we get to the
racist
thing.
Mickey Rooney.
No,
can we talk about racist Mickey Rooney yet?
One thing first.
Oh, wait, there's actually one thing I wanted to say.
Yeah, no, two things then. Because also, right now, Pedro's in my seat back in episode 4 during Ferris Bueller, where we're covering a really popular movie. So I'm the only one who liked it. So Pedro is actually the one who likes the super popular film, which is good. Sure. So, please, what were you going
to say? Oh, no, it was just something I noticed, because they said that she had a southern accent or whatever, and she had to work at it to get rid of it, and she studied French or whatever. It was actually kind of cute how she threw French words in. That was nice.
I thought it was pretentious.
Only because someone I know does it all the time. Anyway, it made me listen to her accent very carefully, and what she had was that fake accent that doesn't exist, that's half British, half whatever.
The transatlantic.
Yeah.
But she was the only one that had it.
Yeah, it's a transatlantic accent, because she has a British accent IRL, and she's trying to speak as someone who lives in New York and grew up in Kansas or wherever the fuck. It's just going to come out weird.
That was the only thing that bothered me.
I'll say one thing about, I think, the greatest scene in the movie, and the scene that like actually works for me on a cinematic level, because I think Blake Edwards' direction is actually really flat here. I think I only like his Pink Panther films. Like, that's all I like of his canon.
Those are great.
And even of those, half are bad. But the ending, as you're getting the really kind of sweeping discussion with Fred Paul, and majority of the dialogue works for me. Like, he is too possessive of words sometimes. It kind of throws me out. But I think Audrey Hepburn's incredible in the taxi cab, but when she gets rid of the cat and then decides to go back to the cat, I think that's great. I think it's a really wonderfully done scene.
Me too. The cat was awesome. Best cat in cinema
Holy
ever.
Holy shit.
We're right on that.
Actually, that cat has its own Wikipedia page.
Really?
That's amazing.
Yeah, no, this cat was like one of the first, I of course went on a deep dive about the cat. The cat was one of like the first really good trained cats in Hollywood. So it's in a lot of movies.
It's a ton
of stuff.
Its name
is Orangey or something. And yeah, it's in a ton of stuff. And like, yeah, training cats is hard, as evidenced by my fucker of a cat. A dumb thing earlier this tonight. She's the worst.
Focus.
I'm mad at my cat right now.
Wait, Adam, it looks like you're pondering.
No, I'm sleepy.
Okay.
But I will say, like, yeah, the cat has his own Wikipedia page, as does the trainer of the cat, because it was like a big deal that the cat was able to really like act in the way that it does, and it does. Like, the cat like does what it needs to do in scenes. In an interesting way.
There's a fun podcast called Skill Set where Amy Nicholson interviews lots of people who are like adjacent to movies, and she interviewed the cat trainer in Keanu.
That's delightful.
And that was a great little interview. Anywho, we avoided it long enough. This film,
God damn it,
has something undeniably bad to it.
The reason that I never got past the first 5 minutes of the film and turned it off immediately 6 or 7 times.
What would that be, Sarah?
That would be Mickey Rooney playing a unbelievably offensive Asian stereotype landlord who is not only, like, really shockingly racist for a popular movie, like, makes you cringe worse than many, many things I can think of, but also isn't funny in any way, and is useless to the plot, and is awful. Like, oh god! It's terrible.
The thing that really pisses me off about this is that they got a white guy, Mickey Rooney, to play this super offensive stereotype. And then later, at Holly's party, there's an Asian woman there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they could have hired an Asian actor for that offensive role.
It would not have been that hard.
No, Kato.
But they didn't.
Kato is a Japanese man who's in a lot of Pink Panther films. The story of how Mickey Rooney was cast, there's actually a really nice making of book about this movie that I read when it came out. The anecdote that sticks with me the most is that, so Blake Edwards was casting this role, and Mickey Rooney came into audition in that outfit, and he hired him on the spot because he couldn't tell it was Mickey Rooney.
Oh.
So Mickey Rooney did a really bold audition and got the role.
It's not okay.
It is terrible. It is just... Wait, Pedro's shrugging.
To be honest, it didn't... Like, I didn't like it, but it didn't kill anything for me. I was just like, alright, whatever.
I thought
I'm
it was
a
so distracting.
Person. No, not at all. Not at all, actually. I was just like, that's a thing, I guess. That's a person.
But it is... To me, it is so offensive and wildly out there.
Yeah.
And it's distracting, and it... you could literally cut every single scene with him in it, and the movie would still make sense.
Well,
he lets the police in. That's the extent.
You could have had another neighbor let in the police. You could have had Fred Paul's lady let in the police, and that would have made that really interesting. But you didn't.
I think even if it was played by an Asian, it would still be pretty offensive.
Oh, no,
super offensive. There's no winning on that character, yeah.
No.
Yeah, it is. People, like, speak highly of this film, and, again, a lot of people love this movie. They all, like, say, except for this. This is the asterisk to a popular film of the go-to example of racism in Hollywood is always Mickey Rooney and Breakfast at Tiffany's. So, on that note, hinges. I give this 3 hinges.
3.3.
1.8.
I already know what I'm going to give it.
That's...
Oh,
it's your turn.
I don't know, just speak.
4.85. Sure. I love this movie.
Secondly?
2.5.
All right, that is Breakfast at Tiffany's by Blake Edwards. You've probably already seen it. I don't need to tell you what to do. But I do need to tell Leigh to tell us what we heard this week.
This week we listened to Oxygene by Jean-Michel Jarre. It is the third studio album by Jean-Michel Jarre, and that's the last time I'm going to say his name, because I know I'm mispronouncing it.
Actually, you've got it right. That's totally right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Cool. That sounds great.
I don't think it has an accent at the end. It might be Jarre, but I think it's just Jarre.
I'll believe you. I speak mostly German. Like, I don't speak French very well. Anyway, this is his third album that came out. It's electronic music. And it was the first album that he made that wasn't intended to be a soundtrack. Although, if you listen to it, totally sounds like a soundtrack.
What does it sound like for people who, I guess, zoned out?
If you took instrumental music inspired by X-Files.
Yes! The X-Files was totally the vibe I got from this, too.
Yeah, and it's not like the opening theme song, it's just like, a little creepy, a little cool, definitely spacey, there's probably aliens somewhere. That's the vibe you get from this.
And it's great.
It does get, like, a bit intense, for like, because it's in sections. It's in 6 sections, I recall?
Yes, it's in 6 sections.
I think the third section was, like, because, like, I listened to this today. And unfortunately, I've just been so insanely tired all day. I have no idea why. And I didn't know what this album was when I pressed play. And this did not wake me up. It put me more to sleep. But that's not a negative thing about the album. It's just a very rhythmically compelling, quiet, creepy video game tone to it. Except for that one section, which was like starts off a bit like louder. And then, of course, goes back to this. I found like sections 1 and 2 to be really similar. Then 3 was like that, and then they were all a little bit different, but in the same umbrella of spooky sci-fi paranoia.
I found that I got really excited every time the bass or the guitar kicked in. Like it was really cool, and then like it was spaced well enough that I felt like anytime you did get something like a melody going, you got really into it because everything had been very atmospheric.
Yeah.
I really, really liked this album.
This album was actually all electronic. It was all synthesizers of various sorts.
I figured it probably was, but it's very well done, and it's done with very good synthesizers because you really wouldn't know.
Especially since this came out in 1976.
Wow,
so like,
that's insane.
For early synthesizer music, it's really well done.
I was not sure whether some of it was real or synthesized. I assumed at least the guitar was real.
Nope, whole thing synthesized. The Wikipedia page has a list of synthesizers that were used on this, if you are interested in that kind of thing. I am not.
Very fair. Adam, did you listen to it?
No.
Oh, I thought you did. Just kidding.
Just a little bit of it, and I just remember beeps.
Sorry, I threw you under the bus there.
That's okay. They would have found out eventually.
Well, I would have told them.
Yeah, I mean, I think instrumental albums are really easy to overlook. And I think that this is one that I'm really glad I got introduced to by this podcast, because it's really cool. And I feel like it has a lot to say. Like, it has a really cool sort of... I mean, it makes sense that he did a lot of soundtracks, because it's got almost like a narrative level flow, where anytime you get a melody or a faster beat, you feel like you're in the middle of, like, the action, and then it sort of goes back into the background, which is cool.
Well, parts of it have been used for various different soundtracks after it was made. Gallipoli is probably the most famous thing.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, it was... Oxygene Part 2 was in Gallipoli, and then parts of it were used for the radio version of the original radio version of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which makes sense.
Makes total sense. Which I haven't heard that, because it was a radio show, then it was a miniseries, and then... But wait, Gallipoli, let's make sure I'm getting this right. That's the Mel Gibson Australian war movie?
Yep. The one with the running, like, yeah. Gallipoli.
That's a good movie. What other kind of soundtracks did he do? Do you know?
I did not get that far.
No worries.
I imagine other things. Others.
you imagine other things?
Type of things. Yeah.
He did other days of work and got Maybe. Paid for them.
Maybe.
I liked it. I mean, I don't know how to... Because typically I, list tracks I liked and whatnot, but...
Yeah, it's harder. It's much more of like a...
But I thought there was enough... It was actually one that I enjoyed listening to all the way through. I'm glad I didn't listen to it in pieces. It was a really satisfying, I don't know, 45 minutes it was.
No, I feel like it is really easy to consume as one piece, yeah. and it's more difficult to try to talk about it as different pieces. It's a very cohesive album, and I really enjoyed it for that.
I listened to the whole album while I was driving, so I wouldn't have even been able to see when the tracks changed. And I couldn't tell you. Like, I have no idea.
Yeah.
What tracks which,
I think it's time for Henges, then.
3.75. It's not quite my cup of tea, but it's definitely worthwhile if you are into synthesizer music from the 70s.
I'll get a 4.2.
Yeah, this really weirdly is my thing, and I kind of didn't realize until I was listening to it. I was like, man, this actually is totally my thing. I'm into this. I'm going to give it a 4.75. I really, really liked it.
I have spent centuries listening to the wrong music.
I know!
It's always been this.
It makes sense, right? Like, it is like video game sci-fi music, which are kind of my jams.
He has done two other parts to this series. The second one is called Oxygene 7 through 13, and then the third one is Oxygene 3. So, and his discography is quite large, so if you want to get more into it, you probably very easily can.
Well, that was the funny thing. Open up YouTube, listen to this, and I just typed in Oxygene. I see 13. I'm like, oh god, I need more time to listen to this. Nope, just 6 the first time.
Yep.
Listen to more. That is Oxygene by French guy.
Jean-Michel Jarre.
It's not in my notes in front of me.
Okay. Whoops.
Anywho, now time for the food section.
Well,
Sarah, I'm hungry.
Yeah, I know. Too bad. Here's the thing. Different people around the world eat different eggs. Eggs of birds. In some parts of the world, it's probably okay to eat the eggs of gulls, because, they're not gross. And so they sell them, like a delicacy, like a little baby egg you can eat. In Chicago, if I wanted to get them, I'd have to, raid a seagull nest, and I ain't gonna do that, because diseases. So I couldn't get these, and I'm sorry.
You know who's my favorite gull? Crixus. Now it's time for the song segment. Pedro, what did we hear this week?
We heard Always On My Mind by Elvis Presley. Well, performed by Elvis Presley.
Maybe I didn't love you quite as often as I could have. Little things I should have said and done, I just never a good time. You were always on my mind.
You were always on my mind is a song written by three people who are not Elvis Presley, because Elvis Presley is one person.
Is and this the first time you've like called someone out for like not writing the song?
No. No.
I mean, it's not his fault. A lot of people don't write their own songs.
No, I think it's the first time Pedro said, like, he's not saying by Elvis Presley. He's a very, like, strong anti-Elvis bias going at the very beginning.
Well, it's not an anti-Elvis thing. I just want to make sure I don't get things wrong by saying by Elvis. I mean, it's not by him. It's as performed by him. And I need to be better about these things. It's, I gotta be professional in my review, Austin.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
All right.
So, first
being professional.
First performed by people.
God damn it.
Gwen McRae and Brenda Leigh in 72. Performed by Elvis in 72, or released by him.
It was in the 70s?
Yeah. Wow. 5 years before he died.
Yeah, this is like right? very late Elvis.
Yeah. Actually, a lot of people take this to be sort of his swan song. Not like him as in like giving, oh, this is the end of my days, but like it's kind of a good recap of, not recap, like just end of career life.
Kind of like
basically solidified the end of his marriage, because that happened like a month before.
Kind of like Gene Hackman for Royal Tenenbaums. It's not Welcome to Newport, his actual last thing, but it's the last great one.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
I liked it a lot. It's Elvis. Actually, I don't know a lot about Elvis. I don't listen to much about Elvis. Or much of Elvis. But it was good. It was nice. It was sweet. The lyrics are cute. Although if you think about it too hard in just the wrong way, it sounds like something cheesy that the guy will play at the end of the day on a stage and then win the girl back. But if you don't think about it that way, then it's real sweet. Ish.
Okay, so you're thinking, like, it could be corny contrived.
Well, because I listened to it on loop a bunch, so, you know, after a while, different takes come into your head, and then at one point I was like, wait, am I listening to it? No, okay, this is Elvis playing a beautiful song. But it could be construed as, and then
it is a little schmaltzy.
It is. I'll take it.
I think the reason why it totally works for me is that I don't think he gets the girl back.
No.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
That's why it's like, it's someone now has like the maturity and the articulation of like,
I was
you're
kid.
The one I've loved and lost.
Yeah.
And yeah, so I think it's a really beautiful song. Mm-hmm. I listened to it several times. I don't know, this is the only version, but the one that I enjoyed listening to was the one with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra.
That was really nice, actually.
Turns out they're pretty good at music.
They really are. Aren't these the guys that...
At the music game?
The London Symphony is the guys that John Williams uses. The Royal Philharmonic is different. But it is royal as in, like, England.
Yeah.
Just making sure.
Yeah.
It was good. I listened to a remastered version, which I assume is taken from the... I mean, it sounded exactly like the Royal Philharmonic one, like, the tracks that weren't orchestra. But, yeah, it was pretty good.
I think there's something about Elvis's, the tenor in his voice that like makes me want to cry all the time.
Right.
Aww, that's
a
true.
Good thing or a bad thing.
One thing that I really liked was, since I haven't really listened to a lot of Elvis, listening to the actual Elvis voice, it is really nice and smooth and soothing. I was expecting to hear like the overdone everyone in the world's voice impersonation of Elvis.
Yeah, the impersonation voice. Yeah,
and I'm like,
he's actually pretty good.
Yeah, he is way better. He does Elvis better.
Elvis does Elvis better?
He does. Yeah. Wouldn't you think it?
Who would have thought?
Nail on the professionalism.
Who would have thought?
No, I like slept too, because I heard a little bit of Elvis. I mean, I've heard like the major songs. And many years ago, when I was thinking about our curses, and before we started to do this, I started to listen to the top 1001 albums. So, start from the beginning, I got like 12 in. But one of them is an Elvis album. And it's like always the greatest hits. It's like Hard Day's Night for the Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, here we go. There's not actually any depth to these songs, but they're super fucking fun. For a whole album. And I go, yeah. That's like, Tutti Frutti? Yeah. That's catchy awesomeness. So that's the only time I really think of Elvis. you know, there's a couple more songs I like, but I don't know. This is my first time, like, knowing this Elvis. Because when I was watching it on YouTube, I saw there's another link for him singing My Way. I was like, I'm not going to listen to that. I want to watch Elvis singing this great Sinatra song. And I heard this now three times. I'm like, okay, he could probably nail that too.
Yep.
Like, I'm now seeing the retired Elvis. And it's really impactful.
The writer, Mark James, had got this in the book. He said that Elvis, quote, recorded a great and memorable performance. Remember him this way as a true soul singer. You don't think of him as a soul singer. You think of him as... Well, I mean, I guess, yeah.
He kind of popularized Blue Eyes Soul, which is where white people did soul songs.
Yeah.
So he kind of...
Did?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe I was a little quick, but... He's good at it. Professional review. Done.
I like Willie Nelson's version better.
I haven't heard it.
So I listened to that because I heard that this was equivalent to Johnny Cash's Hurt in terms of like...
It's so good.
I thought it was fine. I liked it. I thought it was actually a really good cover, but I think I went in with too big of a mindset of like Johnny Cash's Hurt. I think it's just because it's both these guys have a really, like, this is a weird adjective, something I think of at the moment. They have a used voice. This is a voice that has said a lot of words.
Okay.
And both of them had that really well. I think that's the kind of thing that needs to be done for this song, because this is not a teenager song. And so I did enjoy Willie Nelson's version, which, as we have it pulled up right now, it has 30 million views on YouTube, as opposed to Elvis, which has 1 million views.
Well, that is also the one with the Philharmonic Orchestra. I guess it's the top hit, though.
Yeah,
isn't
it's
it?
The top hit.
Yes.
The Willie Nelson one came out in 82.
Huh.
So a bit more, you know.
I
it didn't want a now. Grammy, you know.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah.
So it's good. I do recommend it. I actually prefer Elvis's version.
I will find out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you are.
All right.
You're going to listen to a 3.5-minute song.
Yeah. All
right, guys. Shall we hinge this song now?
No, we got to say yeah some more.
Yeah.
I don't think we have to.
But we're going to.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Y'all are monsters.
Hinges.
Sure.
4.3. 4.5.
4.
4.
3.9.
Alright, that is Elvis Presley's Always On My Mind.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's time for the children's book segment. Adam, what did we read this time?
We read The Day the Babies Crawled Away by Peggy Rathman. And if you can tell by the title, it's a rhyming book, which we haven't had in a while. And I am always delighted when these come around.
It's the imagery of a picture book, because as you're saying this, because the picture book is so large, it feels like you're about to read to us.
Yeah.
We're all looking at you, and you have this big book.
Could.
Yeah, he could read it to us right now in like 3 minutes.
I will. Not. Just kidding.
I was going to call your bluff.
No, I really don't want to.
I don't give a shit.
So it was published in 2003, and I think also illustrated by Peggy Rathman.
And it won a Caldecott, right?
Yeah, it did.
Which is that's the illustration one.
That's
right?
The illustration one. Newbery is the...
Is the book
written.
One.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's about parents who go to a fair, and they get distracted by eating pies, and their babies all go on a little adventure into the woods. And they're pursued by a slightly older young chap of about probably 7 or 8 who kind of has to corral the babies and help them through their little misadventures. And then they eventually all find their way home. And the 7, 8-year-old finds his way home to his mom and tells her all about the story. And it's a really sweet story. And the illustrations are fantastic. We haven't really gotten... anything quite like this. It's all silhouettes.
Yeah, it's really cool.
The foreground is silhouettes, and then it's the sky in the background is the main color. And it's going from kind of like, I would say, 5 p.m. to like a 9 p.m. So you kind of get the feeling like, okay, you got to get these babies back home. So that really adds a nice touch of stakes to it.
And there's really cute details in the silhouettes, I feel like. Like, if you look at every individual baby, like, a lot of them are doing, like, funny, cute little things, and it's fun.
Each time they have, like, a mini story, something from that story follows them and keeps going with them every time. And there's a thing where a dog is giving a kid a slingshot while the parents aren't looking, which I just found fun and maybe foreshadowing.
Is that toward the end?
No, it's the very first page, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, you just see a dog standing up and giving a kid a slingshot. You're like, should that kid be having a slingshot? Why is that dog standing and handing it to him? I think this might not go well.
But turns out it went fine.
Yeah, everything's good.
Thanks to that superhero fireman guy. Second page, maybe?
So, counterpoint. It's not cute.
What?
And it's not the book's fault. But it's one of those things where you've seen other art and now it affects the previous art. You know, that's not fair chronologically. But the look of this book, I even had to Google it to see if it was an influence, is the exact design of the super creepy video game Limbo.
Oh, yeah, I guess so. But, like, this is cool.
As these silhouette children kind of go through this landscape, this is a fun book with, like, lots of very amusing things in every frame, but it's still the exact same, like, layout of the silhouette, because it's all done in silhouette, the whole book is, which is a really cool design that I now associate with a game that came out, like, 10 years later that's super creepy and about a dead child.
Your fault.
Again, it is my fault. I'm saying it's not fair to the book in the slightest, chronologically. But I'm on page 2, page 3, I'm like, it's Limbo. It's Limbo. When's the sun gonna come out? Nope, just Limbo. It's no Limbo, though. If we're going to, you know, be really professional with our reviews.
Oh,
as one must.
As we're going to compare this picture book to a video game.
Even still, that kind of adds a sense of dread to the book.
Which, I mean, it does kind of have that by itself anyway. I mean, like, you definitely are very aware that, like, babies probably shouldn't be on their own. That's probably not so good. What I really love about this book is it's all in the second person. And so the kid who's being read to becomes, like, the hero of the story. And then at the end, it, like, takes that kid to bed, and, like, the kid goes to sleep, and it's just such a lovely...
All happy and heroic.
Yeah, like, it's such a lovely, like, putting a kid to sleep book. It's really cool. I liked it a lot.
Aside from my Limbo
perspective.
Yeah, preoccupation, better word. I didn't find it as charming, I guess. I guess I wanted more farcical.
More rhymes.
Adventures.
Read it again.
Damn.
Okay.
I enjoyed the drawings a lot more than the story, because I feel that's where they really kind of shined with kind of all the small little details. The story itself, aside from when they're coming back up in the sling, because I just turned the page to, that was the one part of the story that I actually felt had the fun adventure I felt that I wasn't experiencing. But
I think that half the story is in the illustrations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you have to... I was noticing Pedro was reading it earlier and taking a lot of time on each page, and I think that's... You really have to do that.
I was trying to find every little... I was like, where's the bee? Where's the butterfly? Mm-hmm. Where's the caterpillar? The caterpillar is my favorite.
Mm-hmm. He also can't read.
There's that problem too.
Reading's hard.
Yeah. So I was actually excited for this book because it has a truly wonderful title, but it's not my favorite. But
this is your bad person.
Because I'm a bad person. You just killed the discussion by accident. Because now we're all just like,
I feel like attention.
Lamenting.
I'm thinking on the illustrations.
Yeah. My only argument against you is that you're wrong.
Which you are.
Which is a strong one. Do you want to hinge it?
I think I will. Yeah. 4.6.
I will also give it a 4.6.
Okay.
3.5.
4.2. Alright, that is The Day the Babies Crawled Away by someone.
Peggy Rathman.
Rathman. You turned the book away from me. I didn't see it.
She also wrote Officer Buckle and Gloria, if that means anything to anyone.
Oh, it does.
You're wrong.
You're right. Now it's time for the television segment. This week I watched Edge of Darkness. Edge of Darkness is one of the most beloved British miniseries ever made. Came out in 1985. It was directed by Martin Campbell, which is noteworthy because A, Martin Campbell's awesome because he went on to make GoldenEye Casino Royale. And also a remake of this miniseries with Bill Gibson, Edge of Darkness, in a movie that I think no one saw in 2011. But I was a film critic, so I saw it, and I forgot all of it. This is the story of a policeman whose daughter is horribly murdered in front of him.
Oh, good.
And in 6 episodes, he investigates what caused this to happen, as it begins with kind of a conspiracy of, like, voter fraud, and goes into a way bigger conspiracy of nuclear power and destruction.
Oh, I was hoping it'd be aliens.
No, it's pretty weird though, because like her ghost is around.
Oh, wow.
I thought it was like supposed to be just like his, like, you know, him not processing it, so he's seeing his dead daughter around. But then like he solves clues from her, and then she starts to give like prophecies of the world fighting back against humanity.
Seems concerning.
I didn't like this one, and it's a controversial opinion, but I'm sitting in a room where no one has seen the miniseries, so, like, I'm not feeling the weight of the pushback. I didn't like it, partly because...
Fuck you.
I know.
Damn it, Austin.
I concur. So, I started off enjoying it quite a bit because it never plays like a procedural. It really plays like an emotional drama of this man who's trying to even just come to terms with the fact that his daughter is dead. But I actually really didn't like the main performance, and this will upset Pedro, even though he's not seen the miniseries or has heard of the miniseries probably. But the main guy is played by Bob Peck, who you will know as the guy who actually said, "Clever girl."
No! Yes! Yes! Oh, I forget his name now, but...
It's Bob Peck.
No, his actual name.
Pedro's reality is hard to understand sometimes.
Yep.
Anywho. But also, the second lead Pedro will also be happy by. It is... what's the guy's name? It's Joe... Yeah, Joe Don Baker. I was right. Who... is quite an actor with no range, but he's very entertaining. He is the official CIA guy, but he's the American in GoldenEye. The CIA buddy.
The big guy who takes a sledgehammer to the car.
Yeah.
Yeah. Written by James Bond guys. I love Casino Royale.
Directed.
Yeah. Close enough.
Pedro's gonna get this higher rating than me.
This is, I already know I like this. 5.
No. The story does continue in an interesting direction, but I never was ever compelled by it because it's such a dreary, slow, and then often preposterous story that as it keeps challenging the genre, I didn't care enough, partly because our vessel through it, Bob Peck, is giving such a limited performance. I know he's supposed to be like in shock for a bit of it, but he's just, the needle's not moving for me in the slightest. And I didn't like the ghost elements and whatnot. And I found the whole conspiracy to be really silly sometimes. It just kind of was hard to imagine that the show starts this way, is now ending with, like, these crazy ridiculous radiation scenes. I didn't buy it, and I don't even think this DVD bought it, because I got this from the library. This is the BBC video, you know, thing. And what's on the front and back, the biggest focus without a doubt is with music by Eric Clapton. That is the biggest focus all over this, over and over again. The plot is not even in like bold letters, but the fact that a giant paragraph about Eric Clapton is.
Did Clapton ever do a Bond song?
Nope.
Well, there you go.
What do you mean, there you go?
This was his chance to get as close as he could.
But he just did the score, and the score is like mid-level Miami Vice episode. It's not that memorable.
But how is his guitar?
It's just that. Just a little bit moody guitar for like a handful of scenes an episode. Stop giving me your thumbs up. It's an audio podcast. Also, you haven't seen the show.
Nope.
So, I'm not a fan. I feel bad because, like, I just reviewed a beloved British miniseries a few weeks ago called Traffic. Didn't like that either. So I'm just a dick, I guess. I want to see The Singing Detective, so whenever we do that, I'm looking forward to that one. Hope I don't like that. But, yeah, Edge of Darkness. Two hinges.
All right.
And that was a flat note for episode
63.
Yay! Woo!
Woo! It's pretty good.
Yep.
Now, Adam, I assume we only have seconds remaining. You were given assignments last week. Did you write it down?
No.
What? What do you mean you didn't write it down?
No.
What are you talking about?
Listen to the goddamn show.
But Adam, hi.
Greetings, immortals.
Hey, intern, how you doing?
Hey.
How's it going?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Doing pretty
fine.
Good.
Fine. Actually, seems like a mixed episode.
Better now that you're here.
Yes, good.
Yeah.
We have homework for me today. Yes?
Yes.
I guess.
Wait, well, sort of.
You?
Oh, I have homework to give. Yes, I do.
Go.
Wait, what do you think homework is?
What's happening?
I was always bad at that, actually.
I know. I know.
So, I came across a little knife.
Wait, we should probably explain, because as we're trying to stop Bethany, the intern, our mole in the Old God Society, we're trying to figure out the best way to stop Bethany, because she is all-powerful and scary, as heard from her interrupting her own show back in episode 50. So, Pedro is looking for relics, and last week he found a rock.
A rock.
A rock.
That may have been to a previous review we did hundreds of years ago, we don't remember.
Mm-hmm.
But
thousands.
Thousands, yeah.
Yes.
We don't know how to do carbon dating. We don't know.
Sure. Well, sure. No, it's Euclid was thousands of, we know that.
Cool. All right, so you're still looking for more relics.
Yes.
What did you find this week?
Well, I went to my most recently refreshed childhood home.
Sure.
And I pulled out this little knife that I always really liked and I always played with and stuff. Turns out there was a little hole in it. Just the right size for maybe a rock. And wouldn't you know it, I put the rock in there, and
what?
A hilt opened up, and the knife got a little bit longer into, like, this mini dagger thing, and it had this nice little glow to it. And wouldn't you know it, there are other little oddly shaped things that seem like maybe gemstones or things are missing from the hilt of now my newly acquired dagger that I think may be powerful.
Fancy.
Yeah.
So maybe.
Maybe we should fill those in and stab Bethany in the stabby stabs.
I think I'm on a quest.
I think that makes sense.
What do you think this podcast has been?
You know.
I mean,
once-a-week hangout time?
I said yes. You guys are the oldest people I know. So, it's, yeah.
You just casually spent a year of your life watching a lot of random shit.
Yeah.
All right. Anywho.
Yes, keep looking into that, Pedro. We're all very excited to see what comes from your glowy knife.
Yeah.
Yep.
I just watched Edge of Darkness. That could be radiation. You should probably watch out for that.
I'm immortal.
Still lose your hair. But, no,
we still. A third arm would be nice, actually.
That'd be weird. But Leigh had a whole theory that it could be a Rumpelstiltskin-like thing.
Oh, true.
So, yeah. Leigh was going to, you know, figure out what, like, at least two names could be Bethany's names. What did you come up with, Leigh?
Well, first, Bethany seems to be sensible in her own way. so she would stick with something that has the same first initial, so she wouldn't have to get new monogram towels.
Sure.
So, Brunhilde.
Obviously.
Okay.
It's good. It's old-timey. Yep. It could work. It's been around for decades and eons. Now, the second one, I'll say it's a little out of left field, and I just kind of made it up and hoping that it might do something. Steve.
Steve makes sense.
Okay.
Steve,
okay.
Have we tried Steve?
We Steve. We'll look into them.
It's out of bounds, and I like the way you're thinking.
There you go.
And now, there's a third task I assigned to Adam, so I will now go to where I take him every time that I possess, and he will tell me.
Well, this is something.
What's happening here?
I think he stopped breathing.
He just looks really still, looking forward, not really emoting.
Is he basically...
that
was quick.
Oh, you know, I've never spoken with Adam, and he is so charming. My...
You locked him in a cage for a week.
Yes. Oh.
He had a different dimension.
He was just a delight. We had some champagne.
Yeah.
We shared some champagne.
There's champagne there?
Wait, in the cage or like
Can
just
we
now?
Have champagne?
When I go there.
Is he still
I
going to
the
cage?
Champagne.
Where does he go now?
Anyway, the story he told me, his idea to defeat Bethany is to bake her a pie. And when she's not looking, push her into the oven.
Ooh, I like that.
Yes,
Hansel and Gretel style.
Yeah, that's...
He does read a lot of children's books.
That's pretty much all he reads now.
Yes.
He used to be a big scholar. Now he just reads picture books.
Well, I like it. I think
all right, so...
Fantastic and charming and hilarious of a story.
Okay, so we have... Quest with the Sword.
Yeah.
Rumpelstiltskin.
Yeah.
And Hansel and Gretel as our game plans to stop an all-powerful...
Yeah.
Godlike being who is cursed and torturing us.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
All right, well, just write that down as an option. Pie oven strategy.
Yup.
I don't see any flaws with it yet.
You didn't write sword down.
Sword.
Thanks.
There's a W in there.
Yeah, you put
right
it.
There. All right, should one of us come up with another plan as well?
Yes.
Who should that be?
I request that Sarah comes up with a plan for next week.
I can do that.
All right.
I would like to see you try.
I will.
I really would.
No, it's really important for your all in danger.
Please do.
But we're seeing the real world ramifications because we know that, like, Trump is the correct, is related to Bethany.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I think that's been the clear implication all the way. I don't really think there was a need to lampshade that. Like, I think...
I'll neither confirm
pretty
nor,
clear.
Nor
yeah.
deny.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll confirm it. It seems pretty, like...
I will neither confirm nor deny.
It matches up with our storyline pretty well.
Your next number is 28!
Ooh, that's early.
Yeah, right? Yeah. That's like 2 14s.
I am real drunk now.
Okay.
That's very confusing that you could drink champagne in a different realm.
It's very
just
strange.
Just that one time.
How much champagne did you drink?
Just
time.
The one.
Just the one champagne?
Bottle?
Very, very strong.
Alright, give me this book here.
Okay.
Number 28. Don't have to go very far. 28. Oh! Yeah, here we go. The Gold Rush. The great Charlie Chaplin comedy.
Oh, I love Chaplin.
Yeah.
Oh, and the food is jamun, which seems to be some sort of Indian plum thing.
Oh, I know that. That's ham.
It's not. That's hamon.
What did you say?
Jamun, which is
they're
not...
ham. Vowel off.
I mean, but they're not the same thing, even a little bit.
I don't know about that.
But they're not.
You already closed the book. I can't see it.
Okay.
We have another famous artist, and I guess troupe. The song is Get Your Kicks On, Route 66, by the Nat King Cole Trio.
It's Route 66.
Yeah, what 66?
Route. I say words the way I like to say them.
You know, it's funny. I regularly say the word route, but I would never call it Route 66. Like, come on now.
I was also reading it off the page, and when I read it, I read route.
Mm. You gotta sing it.
Sorry, was the intern here for a second?
Ooh.
Yeah.
He's that good. He's always inside me. Oh, the children's book is
We're going on a bear hunt by Michael Rosen.
What's the album?
The album is Back at the Chicken Shack by Jimmy Smith.
That sounds silly.
It does.
And the TV show is the sitcom The Phil Silver Show. So.
Cool.
Bam! Big old popular episode next week. So Woo. Get excited for it.
Should be fun.
We'll be back next Thursday as we do this thing again, as we try to, you know, review things, stop Bethany and die. As we'll do in the next 19 years. Yeah.
Yep.
So, anywho, until then, you can follow us on Twitter at The Immortals Pod. You can email us at TheImmortals@TheArtImmortal.com. Please review on iTunes, help people find our show. You can go to TheArtImmortal.com and leave a comment on this episode. We want to know your henge ratings for Breakfast at Tiffany's and Gull Egg and all the stuff we did or didn't cover this episode. We want to know what you think. Do you love Breakfast at Tiffany's? It's now divisive.
I liked it.
Anyway, while you're at the site, you could check out other stuff like, you know, random essays and also other podcasts like Let's Take Five, where Eric and myself are right now 2 weeks into our Stanley Kubrick Five. So tomorrow's episode is review of Paths of Glory. That's pretty cool. And Ad Absurdum, Sarah's legal podcast about pop culture. This month is all about Jurassic Park and Jurassic World. And it is very silly and very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of about that whole thing where when you open up a big old amusement park that's filled with dinosaurs, like, maybe they're going to attack people, and maybe that's not good. And maybe people should be able to sue you for a lot of money.
Yeah. Stick listening to those shows all on the podcast's website, theartofmortal.com, and on iTunes, and on YouTube, which I'll clean up soon, once I have time. Don't judge me. Well, dude... judge me in a positive light on iTunes to get people to find. You get it. You all get it.
I think we're good.
We're all fine now. Right?
Sure.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I need 100% consensus.
Yeah.
Woohoo!
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Close enough for me. I'm Austin.
I'm Adam.
I'm Sarah.
I'm Leigh.
I'm Pedro.
Catch y'all next week. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.